السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. الحمد لله الحمد لله الذي لم يزل عالما قديرا وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد الذي أرسله إلى الناس كافة بشيرا ونذيرا وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كلامه المجيد والفرقان الحميد بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ولنبلونكم بشيء من الخوف والجوع ونقص من الأموال والأنفس والثمرات وبشر الصابرين الذين إذا أصابتهم مصيبة قالوا إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ومن يتصبر يصبره الله ولم يعطي أحد عطاء خيرا وأوسع من الصبر صدق الله المولى العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين والشاكرين والحمد لله رب العالمين. My respected brothers, sisters and elders, although it has been decided that Donald Trump will be our next president, it is an unfortunate fact that both sides, both parties, they are genocidal Zionists and they don't have the best interests of our brothers and sisters in Palestine at heart. And although we have been continuously turning to Allah Ta'ala and we have been even working within the system, and we have tried, for example, going through the protests all across the world, there have been protests. We have been boycotting Israel and Israeli goods. We have been boycotting those who support Israel. We have been speaking to our representatives. We have been even recently tried to vote for the third party to make our voice heard. But unfortunately, the sad fact is that we do not have much sway and influence over the greater politics and the situation. Our only recourse, our one and only recourse is Allah Ta'ala. That we have been turning to Allah Ta'ala in dua, turning to Allah Ta'ala in prayer, turning to Allah Ta'ala for help. This making dua is actually our, you could say, quote unquote, secret weapon. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he's been reported to have said, "Ad-du'a'u silahul mu'min." That dua is the weapon of the believer. That the disbelievers, they don't have this. They cannot turn to Allah Ta'ala. They cannot have their prayers accepted by Allah Ta'ala. It's specifically for the believers. That this is what this, we have to do. We have to turn to Allah Ta'ala in dua to Him. And as we all know, it takes time for du'as to materialize. It's not that we make dua and whatever we want, we get it right away. It takes time for those du'as to materialize. And in fact, having what we ask for materialize, it's not the only way du'as are accepted. There are in fact three ways that du'as are accepted as explained by Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. One is that what we ask for, we get it. We see it materialize in our lives. But another, the second one, is that Allah Ta'ala stores that dua. He does not make that dua materialize in this worldly life. He stores that dua as a reward for us in the hereafter. That dua, we'll only see it on Yawmul Qiyamah. And as has been mentioned, that on Yawmul Qiyamah, you'll see the du'as that were not answered. And you just wish that all of your du'as weren't answered. That's how great a reward Allah Ta'ala will store for those du'as. So that's the second way that Allah Ta'ala accepts du'as. And then the third way is that through making du'a for something, Allah Ta'ala averts another hardship or another difficulty from one's life. That you made dua for something, Allah Ta'ala knew it was better not to grant you that, but on account of your dua, He saved you from something else. Those are the three ways that du'as are accepted. And then the first one, that they actually materialize, like I said, it takes time. That some people, for example, they make dua for children, they try for 10, 20 years, they don't have kids. And then Allah Ta'ala accepts their du'as and they're blessed with many kids. It happens. That it takes time for Allah Ta'ala to make our du'as materialize. It requires us to have patience, And we wait, we have hope in Allah Ta'ala. Inshallah, this situation that that our brothers and sisters are in, it will take time to change. It's up to us to not lose hope and have patience. And Allah Ta'ala says, that we can take solace in knowing that Allah Ta'ala says, وَالْعَاقِبَةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ, that the outcome, the final outcome, the final victory will be for the people of taqwa. That the people of taqwa, they will have the ultimate victory. Either in this life, or for sure in the hereafter. For sure in the hereafter, that we will be in Jannah, inshallah. And we'll be looking down on the disbelievers, oppressors, for all the wrongdoing they have done. We'll be looking down on them in Jahannam, burning before our eyes. So in the hereafter, we will have the ultimate victory, inshallah ta'ala. Now, I mentioned patience. Patience is one of the noblest qualities that one could have in one's life, that one could be adorned with. And it is sufficient as a virtue for patience that one of Allah Ta'ala's names is As-Sabur, the ever-patient. Now the question is that, why would Allah Ta'ala need to be patient? In what situation is Allah Ta'ala patient, quote-unquote? It's been explained that the fact that Allah Ta'ala does not punish His slaves right away, that is His act of patience. That all of His slaves, most of the slaves across the world, they are disbelieving in Allah Ta'ala. They're committing sin after sin. They are doing the worst thing possible, associating partners with Allah Ta'ala. Yet, Allah Ta'ala still gives them food. Allah Ta'ala still gives them drink. Allah Ta'ala still gives them air to breathe. That is Allah Ta'ala showing patience towards these disbelievers. And even ourselves, we commit sin after sin. Yet Allah Ta'ala still even allows us to remain Muslim. So even this hidayah, this is from Allah Ta'ala. Allah Ta'ala still allows us to be Muslim and turn to Him. And regarding the patient ones, Allah Ta'ala says in the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ, that Allah Ta'ala is with the patient ones. And this expression, with, Allah Ta'ala uses it only for three different groups in the Quran. Those people who have taqwa, who are conscious of Allah Ta'ala. Those who do ihsan, who excel in good. And thirdly, those who are patient. That, and also this has only been mentioned, this has been mentioned four times in the Quran, more than the other two groups. That Allah Ta'ala is with the patient ones. Now the question arises that we all firmly believe that Allah Ta'ala does not have a physical body, that He cannot just stand beside us. So what does it mean that Allah Ta'ala is with us? What this means is that Allah Ta'ala, His support and help will always be with the patient ones. That Allah Ta'ala's support and help will always be there for those who exercise patience in the face of hardship and difficulties in their lives. And this quality of patience, being granted this quality, it's not something small and insignificant. It's a very great blessing of Allah Ta'ala. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he says, وَمَنْ يَتَصَبَّرْ يُصَبِّرُهُ اللَّهُ. Someone had recently asked me that now I'm 50 years old, I don't see my level of patience increasing. That I don't have more patience, that I'm getting older and wiser, but I'm not getting more patient. So I told him this beginning part of this hadith, which means whoever makes an effort to exercise patience, Allah Ta'ala grants him more patience. وَمَنْ يَتَصَبَّرْ يُصَبِّرُهُ اللَّهُ. And then Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, وَلَمْ يُعْطِي أَحَدٌ عَطَاءً خَيْرًا وَأَوْسَعَ مِنَ الصَّبْرِ, that no one has been given some blessing or bestowal greater and more comprehensive than sabr. That this is a great blessing of Allah Ta'ala, that one has patience. That our brothers and sisters in Palestine, the amount of patience they have, this is from Allah Ta'ala. This is a blessing from Allah Ta'ala. And we should ask Allah Ta'ala for the same as well. And those who had the most patience were the prophets alayhi wasalam. All the prophets, this was a salient feature and characteristic of their lives, that they had patience in all situations. That Nuh alayhi salam, as we know, he gave da'wah to his people for over 950 years. 950 years, it's unfathomable. That we cannot even imagine living that long, let alone calling, making da'wah to Allah Ta'ala and being rejected for that long. That he gave da'wah for so many years and only a handful of people accepted Islam in his hands. That requires a great amount of patience. Us, that we go to work, we tell someone, oh, have you heard about Islam? Oh, I'm not interested. Great, goodbye. We don't even try. We don't have that much patience. He had patience for 950 years. And even later in his life, when the flood came, right before his eyes, his son refused to accept Islam, and he drowned right in front of him. That takes patience to lose your son right in front of you, drowning and dying in kufr. Then, as you know, Ibrahim alayhi salam, he was shunned by his people as a young child. He recognized Allah Ta'ala as a young child, and his people shunned him. And eventually, they tried to throw him in the fire. How much patience did he have in that situation? And then later, when he grew older, he went to Namrud, the tyrant king Namrud, who thought he was Allah Ta'ala, who claimed he was Allah. He had patience to deal with this such an ignorant person. And then Ibrahim alayhi salam lived over 100 years and he still had no children. Over 100 years and no children. He had to exercise so much patience that for after 100 years you still don't have children. And then when Allah Ta'ala did eventually bless him with a child, Ismail alayhi salam, he was commanded to slaughter him. What amount of patience is this? And even after Musa alayhi salam, we all know the story that how he was living a life of luxury amongst the people of Egypt. And then he was kicked out and he had to live a life of poverty in the desert in Madian before he was a prophet. And then after becoming a prophet, he had to deal with Fir'aun, such a ruthless tyrant. And his dialogue is mentioned in the Quran. He was a very obstinate and obnoxious person himself. Musa alayhi salam had to exercise so much patience to deal with him. And then after Fir'aun was disposed of, then Musa alayhi salam had to exercise so much patience with the Bani Israel. They were very, very, they pestered him and bothered him so much that, for example, Allah Ta'ala would send down food from the heavens. And they would say, no, we don't want this, we want garlic and cucumbers and other stuff. Or when they say, we want to see Allah Ta'ala. Who asks such a question? They say, we want to see Allah Ta'ala. Or they would say that, they started worshipping the calf. All of these things Musa alayhi salam had to deal with. He had patience throughout his life to deal with all of these hardships and difficulties. And then as we know, the paragon of patience, Ayyub alayhi salam, the sickness he went through, such a sickness that everyone runs away from you. Everyone leaves you. All of your wealth is finished. Such an extreme sickness. Yet he exercised patience in the face of this. And of course, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, all the incidents that happened in his life, in the beginning, persecution at the hands of the disbelievers, being boycotted for 2 long years, him and his family and tribe stuck in one place for 2 long years. And after that, he goes to Taif to call them to Islam. They disrespect him. They make the children throw stones at him until he bleeds. And even in his life, he lost so many people. He lost his mother, he lost his grandfather, he lost his uncle who disbelieved, he lost his uncle who was brutally murdered. He lost his beloved wife, Khadija radiallahu anha. He lost all of his children except for one. Oh, he lost his grandchildren, he lost his companions. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam experienced so much loss, so much grief, so much difficulty. Yet he was the exemplar of patience. And the fact is that, as we have seen, the Anbiya alayhi salam, they had to go through difficulties, and we all have to go through these difficulties. That Allah Ta'ala says, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ. And in Arabic, it's a style of heavy emphasis, that surely indeed, we will try you, we will test you, we will put you through difficulties. بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ. Of hunger, of fear, of losing lives, of losing wealth, a decrease in income, all of these different types of difficulties, Allah Ta'ala says that we will surely put you through these, that you will definitely experience all of these things. But at the end, Allah Ta'ala says, وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ. Give glad tidings to the patient ones. الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. Those who, when they are afflicted with the hardship, they say, we belong to Allah Ta'ala and to him we will return. And this phrase, we say it all the time, but this phrase has a very deep meaning. That we belong to Allah Ta'ala. That just like we can do whatever we want with our property, with our belongings, Allah Ta'ala can do whatever He wants with us. Because we belong to Allah Ta'ala. He takes someone we love, He can do that. He can cause us difficulty, He can do that because we belong to Allah Ta'ala. وَإِنَّا إِلِهِ رَاجِعُونَ And we will return to Him. That the deeper meaning of this is that this life is temporary. Whatever hardship we're experiencing, it cannot ever equate to eternity of bliss in Jannah. That it's all temporary, it'll all come to an end. And we will return to Allah Ta'ala and He will give us a great recompense, great reward for the hardships and difficulties we endured in this life. So whenever we say, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un, that is what we should be reminding ourselves of, that we belong to Allah Ta'ala and we will return to Him. And it's through sabr itself, through sabr, this act of sabr, that whatever hardships and difficulties we endure, it becomes a source of khair for us. And whatever bad that's happening to us, it becomes a source of khair. How is that so? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says in a very beautiful hadith, he says, عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ الْمُؤْمِنِ That how amazing is the matter of a believer. How amazing it is. وَلَيْسَ ذَاكَ لِأَحَدٍ إِلَّا لِمُؤْمِنِ And this thing that he's about to say, it's only specifically for the believers. It's for no one else. None of the disbelievers get this special benefit. In أَصَابَتُ السَّرَّ شَكَرَ فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ That if he experiences good things in life, good things come his way, he shows gratitude to Allah Ta'ala, and that is فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ That is good for him, that is full of goodness for him. Goodness in this life and goodness in the hereafter. And the opposite, when أَصَابَتُ ضَرَّ And when hardship and difficulty comes his way, صَبَرَ فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ He exercises patience, and that is good for him. That by exercising patience, whatever hardship one is going through, it'll become a source of reward and khair in this life and in the next. And whatever I've been mentioning, these are hardships of patience in the face of hardships. But that's only with one type of patience. There are other types of patiences as well. One is patience, a sabr ala ta'a, that patience in the face of, patience for obeying the commands of Allah Ta'ala. That it takes patience to even fulfill the commands of Allah Ta'ala. That to wake up in the morning for Fajr takes a lot of patience. To lift up that blanket, it's harder than any workout. Or to go to the masjid, it takes patience. To give our zakat, to lose our money, it takes patience. To fast, not eat and drink, takes patience. Then Hajj, so much patience is required there. It all requires patience. That this is the patience when fulfilling the commands of Allah Ta'ala. And another type of patience is as-sabr ala al-ma'asiyah. That patience in the face of sins. And that it takes patience to not look at the woman on the billboard. Or it takes patience to not lie and cheat. It takes patience to not gossip and backbite. All of these things require a degree and a level of patience. And by knowing that such a patience exists, patience in the face of obeying Allah Ta'ala, patience when in face of sins, knowing this, knowing that there is such a thing, then we can inshallah anticipate reward from Allah Ta'ala for this as well. And it is famously known that to complain goes against patience. That when you complain, you're not being patient. So now someone could object that in the Quran, Yaqub alayhi salam, he says that, إِنَّمَا أَشْكُو بَثِّي وَهُزْنِي That I complain of my grief and my sorrow. Or Ayyub alayhi salam, he says, مَسَّنِيَ الضُّرْ I've been afflicted by hardship. That someone could say they are complaining. It's in the Quran, they're complaining. So, what's important is that there has to be a distinction between complaining about the decree of Allah Ta'ala and complaining to Allah Ta'ala. that I deliberately omitted parts of the verse. He says that أَشْكُو بَثِّي وَحُزْنِي إِلَى اللَّهِ, that I complain of my grief and sorrow to Allah Ta'ala. And Ayyub alayhi salam, same thing, I omitted رَبِّي مَسَّنِيَ الضُّرُّ وَأَنْتَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّاحِمِينَ, that, oh my Lord, I have been afflicted by hardship and you are the most merciful. That one is to complain about what Allah Ta'ala has decreed. And another is to complain to Allah Ta'ala that, oh Allah, I am weak. Oh Allah, I am in need. Oh Allah, I'm in suffering. I need your help. That is good, to complain to Allah Ta'ala. Allah Ta'ala wants that from us. But He does not appreciate us complaining about what He has decreed for us. Now, I've been mentioning patience, but what is the application of patience? I would say the foremost application of patience is with our families. That our families, we have to exercise great patience with them. And it has become common now in the West here, the non-Muslims, that they say that, oh, so-and-so, my family is toxic, I don't talk to them, we're not on speaking terms. Or I don't speak with so-and-so, I don't speak with my brother, I don't know him anymore. That happens so often here. But that goes against the teachings of Islam. That in the numerous places in the Quran, Hadith, there's a reward mentioned and the emphasis given to Silatul Rahim, that maintaining ties of kinship. When Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he received the revelation from Allah Ta'ala for the first time, he was awestruck and he rushed home. And he said to Khadija radiallahu anha, cover me. And he thought that he was being punished by Allah Ta'ala, or someone, a jinn was about to afflict him or something. So Khadija radiallahu anha, she consoled him that how can Allah Ta'ala afflict you? That you're such a good person. So one of the qualities of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that she mentioned was إِنَّكَ لَتَصِلُ الرَّحِمُ, that you maintain ties of kinship. This was a quality of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam even before he became a prophet of Allah Ta'ala. So and the reward for this is so great, because unlike friends, you can break a tie with a friend, but you can never actually break that tie or that relationship with a family member. Someone will always, you'll always be a father, you'll always be a brother, you'll always be a mother, you'll always be a sister, you'll always be some relationship that'll always remain. So you can't actually cut them off. Now that's why the reward for it is so great. It's not like friends that you can let go of them, where you have to stay connected with your family. You have to exercise patience with them. And this is, out of all the family members, this is the case, especially so with one's spouse. That unlike other family members, with the spouse, you can actually break that relationship. You can engage in divorce. So now it's even greater, it's greater and more important to maintain that tie and exercise patience in that relationship. In fact, it's mentioned in the hadith that shaitan, the head shaitan, Iblis, he rewards and crowns one of his smaller shayateen for breaking a tie between a husband and wife. That's the ultimate thing that one of his cronies could do. Break that relationship between husband and wife, the foundation of a family, of society. So that is the place where we have to exercise the most patience. That our spouse we see on a daily basis, that's the foremost application of this quality of patience. And I'll just end with a story that once a Sahabi, he was experiencing marital problems. So he went to Umar radiallahu anhu, and this was after Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away, after Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu passed away, Umar radiallahu anhu was the Khalifa. So he goes to him, and he thinks that I'll go to the Amir al-Mu'mineen, he will help me with my marital problems, he'll give me some good advice. So he goes to his door, and as he's about to knock, he hears pots and pans being thrown everywhere and a woman yelling. So then he thinks to himself that I have marital problems, I'm coming to him for help, but it seems like he has his own problems. I don't think he can help me. So then he starts to walk away. Then Umar radiallahu anhu, he hears someone at the door, that someone was there. So he rushes out. What happened? How can I help you? So he said that I needed help with my marriage, but it seems like you have your own problems. So he said that, look, my wife, she gave birth to my children. She looks after my children. She takes care of the home. She looks after my needs. She does so much for me. I need to exercise patience with her, that I need to appreciate all the things that she does for me, that I can overlook all of these things that she's doing because she does so much more for me. So this is the relationship wherein sabr is most necessary. So may Allah Ta'ala give us the ability to exercise patience in all aspects, in obedience of Allah Ta'ala, in sin and in hardship. And may Allah Ta'ala alleviate the suffering of our brothers and sisters in Palestine. Ameen. Wa akhidah. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen.